Right, welcome back, class, and to today's session. We're doing a new product introduction of a new financial product or financial services product. I think in the past session we did the distribution of financial services, and I think there were quite a lot of things that we talked about. Now, obviously, after a while, every business would want to reinvent, would want to modify, would want to bring or breathe a new set of life into their product portfolios or service portfolios. So new product introduction is very much to the heart of the growth of businesses, because without that, then of course you spell your own doom, because the market is dynamic, people are dynamic, taste is dynamic, people's interest, people's taste for certain products and services change over time. And as a result, companies or businesses would have to factor that in introducing a new product. Gone are the days where products were actually developed, as a lifetime. Now, most of companies that actually kind of followed on that particular path didn't actually survive, because you couldn't actually have a lifetime, kind of product. Product must actually evolve as human beings evolve, and they must be dynamic. And as a result, new product introduction is very much, crucial to services, financial services marketing, and hence, this particular session. So, as usual, we have the session overview, actually saying that when it comes to, financial services, new product introduction is fairly easy, as compared to the other type of product innovations. You don't sometimes necessarily need technology, to actually, come out with new product. It's essentially about, attribute addition or attribute subtraction and modifying certain parts of the product. Obviously, there had been other new products introduced into the financial services market that is predominantly technology-based. Of course, we can talk about ATMs, and now moving to the VTMs, that is the video teller machines, that we're now talking about as a new big thing in the financial services marketing. We have also seen the growth, or the exponential growth, if I should say, of mobile money, again, reliant on what we call technology as the backdrop, to grow. And other, type of what we call products and services in financial services, but predominantly, most of these, new product that have been introduced into the financials do not necessarily require, technology. They actually been one or two, additions or subtractions of attributes. As usual, the session outline looks at the sample of new product in financial services, recall dimensions of typical financial product, how are new product created, and method for defining relevant attribute, or method for identifying relevant attributes when it comes to financial services, and that would actually help you to create a new product. And we'll look at those methods. As usual, we have the reading list. Yes, so samples of new product in financial services. Over the years, like we said, we have seen quite a number of new product coming up. Typically, we have seen a kind of a modification, or we have seen some kind of co-branding of the financial services product. Typical example is the season pass insurance for skiers. Skiing is a very fun game that actually predominant obviously relies on snow and the board, but also it could be a little bit risky. So there had been kind of introduction of insurance packages in skiing, but also people have had passes, season passes for popular skiing kind of locations that is typically targeted towards people who love skiing. So obviously, if you have a season pass to a particular, a skiing, kind of location, or, it's a fantastic thing for people, that actually love skiing. So we have seen that. We have also seen a different type of mortgage. Mortgage is such that when you miss payment, obviously you get a letter, and then when you miss another, you get your property boarded. Now, over the years, we've seen products that actually targeting missed payment and saying that, well, missed payment may not necessarily be your fault, or you may have had one or two financial challenges that is not permanent, and as a result, we could actually introduce something to sort of offset, you know, the negativities of missed payment. And therefore, some businesses have been smart to introduce a missed payment option as part of the mortgage, offer. So you take up a mortgage and you take missed payment option, which means that perhaps your monthly payment, you know, would be slightly higher than the usual one, so that just in case you miss a payment, that actually takes care of it, and then you don't actually get the usual headache of thinking about whether your property is going to be boarded and things like that. And now we've seen the growth or the emergence of, you know, identity theft. You know, people over the years, because of sophistication the IT systems or sophistication of technology, people have managed to steal the identity of others, you know, for their own personal gains. And as a result, people have been concerned about whether the identities have been stolen and for what purposes and things. So insurance companies have actually developed a new product to take care of that and then to take care of people's concerns. So identity theft is very much, you know, a new product in insurance. I think in our case, when we have to bring it back from the global to much more local setting, like Ghanaian case, for example, we can look at the paragliding festival and say, can an insurance company introduce a particular insurance package to take care of that? We know that insurance works in a way that there are certain risks that insurance wouldn't take, you know, especially if you have a wooden house, probability that you're going to have a fire is great, and as a result, insurance companies won't actually take care of that. You know, we know that if you have a cancer, you know, it's terminal, and therefore insurance companies usually don't actually go on that line. But we have also seen, crucially, in other countries like Japan, for example, introducing cancer insurance, you know, to take care of that. And we've seen quite a number of other products. So for example, the Kowu paragliding, which is a mountainous kind of festival, people who actually use, you know, that flight type of thing to fly over, you know, the cliff and things like that. You know, can we, you know, sort of introduce some kind of insurance, you know, to take care of that? And that is not to say that it's a high risk, but it's to say that it's kind of to forestall people's fears or people's, you know, kind of anxiety about, you know, whether, you know, they are safe in doing that and things like that. Yeah. So these are some of the things that we can actually introduce. Of course, we've seen new product introduction in insurance industry in Ghana, for example, the mobile money company like Tigo, is it? Tigo, Eta, one of them, has an insurance package that whenever you buy a credit, you get a little bit saved, you know, in your, you know, as an insurance for you, which is a new product. It never used to be there. And other quite a number of new product, you know, introduced in the Ghanaian system. Now, when we talk about recall of financial services, the dimensions are clear. Usually in the financial services, the input, that is how much you contribute, is always recalled. You always know, or it's always a fundamental part of the product. You know, how much do you pay upfront, or how much do you pay as your monthly, you know, contribution is always recalled. Now, the term of the policy is always recalled. Is it an annual policy, 18-month policy, 2 years policy, 36-month policy, and that kind of thing is always recalled. That's also a fundamental part of it. And then the risk aspect. You know, every financial services has a risk component, and it's fundamental to the product. You know, what is your credit rating, for example? You know, what is the name of a company that is managing your mutual fund? You know, is a risk, you know, dimension, because the popularity of the brand or the well-known of the brand actually gives you some kind of confidence, you know, that this bank, for example, had kind of resided in the country for centuries. So you know that the risk of you losing your money is very, very low. And that is also a very typical part of financial service. And then the output, you know, the payout that you get, whether it be an insurance, whether it be a check account, whether it be, you know, a savings, whether it be a mutual fund, always these four components are part of the financial services product. Also, we have the non-core attributes, you know, which could be like installment payments, you know, or maybe a CSR, that is a corporate social responsibility part of a particular mutual fund. Now, they're all part of the product, but some are core, some are, you know, kind of non-core, you know, to the financial services. Now, examples of some of the financial services new product. We have mutual fund, for example, funds load, that is how much you put in, there's the input, performance, output, company name, which company is actually managing, or the brand name. And here we have what you call data bank, for example, you know, and then we have data banks, EPAC, and all those, you know, funds that they have, or schemes that they have, you know, would actually serve as a risk level, you know, or risk, you know, factor. The time restrictions, for example, the time frame or the, you know, the length of the scheme. Socially responsible investment focus, like I said, is a non-core attribute, for example. And the new product that has been introduced, mutual fund, we have socially responsible mutual funds. And right now, you know, to we have mortgages, flex mortgages, that is flexibility of making a payment, you know, and then being allowed to miss some payments, and all those things have actually been in the system. And then absolute travel insurance. Now we have coverage for skin accidents, season pass insurance, and all those. You know, auto insurance, we have direct insurance where you can actually pay online or do every transaction online and things like that. Well, obviously that has never been part of the Ghanaian system. We're yet to see insurance company going online or making a direct kind of contact by a direct line, like calling on phone or buying online without necessarily going to a forecourt, you know, kind of premises. We're yet to see that. How a new product created? Like I said, when it comes to financial services, the creation of the product is slightly easier than other kind of product and services. It's either you modify a particular, you know, attribute, or you add to a particular attribute. For example, motorcycle plus ease of handling, it gives you what, scooter. And then mortgage plus missed payments, flex mortgage, like we have discussed. Travel insurance plus need of skiers, season pass insurance for skiers, you know. Now, if you look at our system, for example, and like I said, with the introduction of insurance, you know, by, is it Airtel? I'm not really, is it Airtel, right? Airtel Insurance. Yeah, that is also how one creates a new product. So it doesn't, you don't necessarily make a conscious effort of buying insurance, but they're saying that you can put a little bit away, you know, for yourself, you know, that you would need in case of need, or it would be beneficial in case of need, by just buying what, a top up. And that is a fantastic, you know, kind of product, because your aim is buying a top up. But in the same way, as you're buying a top up, the company is helping you to save a little down, or to put a little bit of money down for insurance purposes, which is fantastic, you know. And that's one of the new ways of creating what you call a new product. So essentially, is a mobile telecommunication thing, is a communication need that you have. But as you satisfy your communication need, you're also satisfying your insurance need by putting something away for your life, you know. And then measure of existing categories, station wagon plus a van gives you a minivan, you know, that's an example, you know. Credit card plus traveler's check will give you travel funds card by American Express. Check account plus credit card gives you a debit card and all that. I mean, we know that in our system now, some companies have actually thought it wise, knowing that a lot of people have their relatives abroad and may want to remit money to them, and which is not an easy process, have created a debit kind of system, debit card system, where with your card here, or you can just create an account here, post a card to the relatives abroad, and they can use it to retrieve money. So all that you do is you put the money into the account here, relatives retrieve it abroad. Fantastic, you know. So it's more or less like a travel card kind of system, but it serves both ways, both locally and then internationally. Methods for defining relevant attributes for new products. So how do we identify, you know, new attributes that customers will like? How do we know that, you know, if we introduce this particular, kind of service, or if we add a particular, you know, attribute to already existing service, it would be interested, customers will be interested. Now, we have so many ways of identifying or determining, you know, attributes that customers will like. And these are the five attributes that we can actually look at. Observation and methods, you know, How do we observe through their line of activities to understand or to come to a realization? I think when we introduce this, the customers will like, because over the years, you deal with customers, frontline deal with customer managers, listen to customers' complaints, and so many of us are actually interfacing the customer almost every day. Now, it makes it possible for us to essentially identify, you know, certain things that we think the customer would like as a result of our daily what experiences with them. Then apart from that also, we can issue questionnaires and ask people, you know, whilst they are patronizing or they're actually consuming the product, we can ask them certain few, you know, short open-ended questions for them to do what? To express their feelings and to express their expectations. And as a result, we can use that to modify, you know, or add to the product. Focus groups. We can ask from time to time also organize some consumers and say, is it possible for you to spend a little bit of time with us? Let's say 5 minutes, 10 minutes. You know, usually focus group goes about an hour anyway. Yeah, but can you spend just about an hour with us as a client, as a lawyer client that we have been dealing with you for some time? We just want to better the service, want to better the service that you get. And then once you sell the benefits of focus group to them, yeah, they would open up, have a sit with them, have a chat, and find out, you know, what else do they expect the service to produce. And then also attribute ratings. At a point, you may also want to engage customers with a list of attributes and, you know, through, you know, Likert scale, ask them to rate which attribute they fascinates them best, or which of them would they want to, you know, experience more of it, which of them would they want to be removed out of the service provision. So these you can actually do as a way of identifying attributes and benefits, you know, that customers would like. For example, source of information for observation. We say managers' opinions on customers' needs. Yes, because managers have engaged customers in one way or the other, escalated complaints, you know, usual chit chat, you know, with customers, and mere observation of the banking premises or the premises that in which they work. So with that, you'll be able to have a fair idea of what it is suitable or not suitable for customers. So we need to place a deposit box next to the ATM machine. For example, you've seen customers mostly coming to queue up for ATM, for example. Or you've seen people going into the banking hall. Obviously, if they want to access money, they use the ATM, but if they want to deposit, they just go to the banking hall and it becomes crowded. Perhaps you may think about, you know, putting a deposit box next to the ATM machine for people to use. We need to introduce a low-cost home warranty, you know, product to our first-time mortgage applicants. Again, you would want to actually do that. Maybe you have observed that first-time applicants actually find it difficult in accessing in a mortgage, for example. So would you want to do a low-cost home warranty for them? Observation of customers' transaction and their physical movement. Again, you have installed, you know, CCTV or surveillance cameras over time. So you might be able to observe, you know, the coming in and going out of customers and know what other services do you think you could actually provide. For example, whether your accessibility to the banking hall is convenient or very, easy, you know, for customers. What about challenged customers? Do they find it easy to actually use those facilities? So CCTVs, for example, will give you a fair idea of whether your premises is accessible to everybody, and it makes it convenient for maybe mothers who come to the banking hall with their children and things like that. Do you have facility to facilitate their services or their patronizing, you know, services in the branch? Well, advantage is that it's inexpensive to do observation, but the disadvantage is that you can get it wrong. You may not be accurate because you have only observed. So there's a need for you to sort of combine observation with other methods, you know, so that you will be able to get a fair idea of what the situation is like. Open-ended questions, like we said, in as part of the consumption of the service, you can actually provide maybe one question each. Because usually when people are patronizing services, especially banking services, they may be using their spare time, maybe their break, you know, time, they want to rush into the branch quickly and come back. So when you want to use open-ended questions in maybe in during the day that they're assessing the product, it shouldn't be this long and it shouldn't be that complicated. It has to be just one sentence, for example. Or do you think that we could actually do this one any better than what it is now? The person takes yes and goes. All right. Or you can have a much more organized kind of a process or a survey, you know, where you can distribute questionnaires and ask, you know, consumers or non-consumers to express their views in that. Again, sample size, you can have a target of 50 to 300 in questions. Data analysis, tabulation of customer responses, obviously. Focus group, usually between 10 plus the moderator, 8 to 10 plus the moderator, an hour is sufficient. One-way mirror plus video recording. Sometimes you can put one-way mirror. There are some focus groups that have used mirror. You know, they put mirrors there to just, you know, as part of the observing, or as part of the listening to customers, they're also observing their, you know, attitude, their posture. You know, because sometimes people will be giving you responses, but their posture tells something else. So you want to analyze just the face value of what they're saying, and at the same time analyze the nuances and analyze some of the gestures that would actually be taking place during the session. And then also you want to put video recording sometimes, but of course remember, usually some of these devices, when you're using it, you've got to actually make it clear. Ethical position actually suggests that you've got to let customers know, or respondents know, that it's being recorded, but for that purposes only. And then open format questioning. Today we'd like to get your opinions on deposit boxes in a bank. Let the questions be very unambiguous. Let it be very straightforward, and let it be very understandable to everybody else, you know, so that people can contribute. Of course, when it comes to the moderator, you want to control, you know, the session, because some people may be overly talkative, others may be, you know, overly quiet. So how do you do to kind of incite both ways to make sure that people know when to shut up and people know when to speak up? Then of course, control the vocals and encourages the silence. Must be careful not to bias express opinions. But crucially, the setup of the makeup of the focus group itself is very essential. You know, do you want to put both male and female together? Do you want to put only male together? Do you want to put, it's essential, the combination. Do you want to put adult and young people together? Because the dynamics of such groupings is critical. You know, there are some questions that is uncomforting putting male and female together, especially looking at the cultural diversity and cultural issues. You know, it may not necessarily be helpful putting male and female together to talk about wages. People sometimes don't want their partners, colleagues, or friends to know how much they are earning, so they may not tell you the truth. You know, so if you tell them, okay, how much do you earn and how much would you want to save, they may actually tell you, well, I don't earn a lot. What do you mean by a lot? You know, something like that. So you've got to understand the cultural settings and the social settings of some of these things, and make sure that the grouping, the formation of your focus group, is watertight, so that you don't, you know, kind of unduly, you know, limit the study in that sense. Attribute rating. Again, like I said, you want to, you know, let customers rate the attributes predominantly, which one they think they like or they don't like, or which one they think they would like to pay more, which one they think they wouldn't want to pay any less or any bit money towards it. So on a scale of 1 to 5, with 5 being very important, please rate the importance of the following attributes in choosing a check account. So, well, check here is because it's American spelling, my apologies. Yeah, so location of a bank branch, yeah, so 1 to 5, maybe 5 is crucial to this person. Monthly maintenance charge, 4 is crucial to this person. Minimum balance requirement, again, 4. Availability of line of credit, 2, is not that important to them. Ability to look up transactions online, 3. Free customized checks, 5. Again, you know, depending on the customer type or the segment. Analysis of attribute rating. So the percentage of top box, ages between 18 to 30 cohorts you have, and 31 to 45 cohorts, 46 plus. Location of the bank branch is important to 30% of these cohorts, is important to 65% of these cohorts, and 46 plus years, 88%. So you can see that the 46 plus years, Deem location of branch very, very important. The next of importance is 65, and the next of importance is what? In the 30. Why do you think that between that age cohort, 18 to 30, don't really see location of bank branch as important? You know, that tells you that it is not, you're not restricted by geographic distance because of online. Majority of these are hugely online. They do mobile banking, they're likely to do, well, they do internet banking, they are most likely to do mobile banking. But here, these people, 46 plus, majority of them are not internet savvy. And even if they are internet savvy, they don't feel safe online. Their risk profile, in terms of risk expectation actually, online is very high. So they're very uncomfortable in using internet, you know, banking, for example. So predominantly, the location of the branch is crucial to them, you know, less than the 18 to 30 cohort. Monthly maintenance charge, again, it is very important to 18 to 30 years, less important to 46 years plus. Why? Because these people, they don't want to pay anything, you know. They crucially are perhaps starters, you know. They don't have that much money to spend, and therefore they wouldn't want to spend unnecessarily, you know, on some bank charges and things like that. So it's not fashionable to them. Minimum balance requirement, yes, you can see these people, 30 to 45 years, very, very important to them. Yet, you know, these people, they're not very, very important. Availability of line of credit, and you can see the difference. Why is line of credit very important to 31 to 45? Majority of them are going to be family houses, you know, family homes, you know, because they're sort of a mid-level, you know, families of my age, for example. And in most cases, you have a strict, tight budget, you know, school, paying for school fees, doing that, taking care of perhaps mommy and daddy in one way or the other. So they're always tight on budget. So the line of credit, hugely important, you know, to them as part of their financial needs. And then, of course, these people, 57, because majority of these people are actually nearing towards retirement. They have certain investments in place and things like that, you know, that actually earns them quite a lot of money. So they may not necessarily be so much tied up with you know, inflows or with liquidity. But yet still, they may be needing it for other purposes. And then 18 to 30 years, well, they may not have too much of responsibility, but yet they will still want to use it for some techies and, you know, buying some apps or some new tabs and things like that. So they also will see it as important, but not so much important. And then ability to look up transactions online, huge. And you see how it ties into with this one? You know, 95%, 30% here. That means that the internet is a big part of their lives, you know, and they would never sacrifice for anything. Look here, zero. That response corresponds with this one, 88%, 0%. No way, they don't want the internet. You can actually take it off, you know. So if you say that, which one do we strike off? Oh yeah, take the internet off. You know, we don't need it. So that's an example. But free customer checks, yes, 92, 48, and 35, you know, as a customized checks. All right, so unserved important attributes. There are certain attributes that have never been served, but then it's an opportunity for a new product development. So number of branches, percentage of customers rating attribute as very important. So 80% of people rating number of branches as important. If you look at the competitors, it means that these competitors are much more in a good position than us as a competitor, for example, if you're using yourself as a rating, and they're about, you know. So again, you can look at it. The next, you know, way of determining, you know, value or determining attributes that are of value to customers is what we call a congruent analysis. Now, congruent analysis usually is about, you know, a series of tests where you ask people to eliminate or to, you know, kind of determine which of the attributes are so important to them. And as you do it over time, you arrive at a set of attributes that predominantly cut across, you know, the customer sections or the segments, and then you factor that in into, you know, the product, you know, design as a new product. So you have an example, credit card. So product attributes, attribute levels. So introductory APR is what? 33% versus 6%. £25 or $25 annual fee, let's say Ghana cedis, sorry. 25, you know, Ghana cedis annual fee, yes versus no. So the point is, how many customers are comfortable with 3% introductory APR versus 6% introductory APR? How many of them are comfortable with paying an annual fee of 25 Ghana cedis and those who are not, you know, comfortable? And how many are comfortable with 5% refund program and how many are not comfortable with 5% program? So you give them these profiles. So profile 1 to 8, that is the profile, means that the various, you know, kind of attribute that you want to introduce. So the first attribute, you have introductory APR being 3%, annual fee no, refund yes. The next profile, 3%, annual fee no, refund no, annual fee yes, refund yes, annual fee, introductory APR 3%, annual fee yes, no. So as you put these questions before them, they choose. How much do you like this product? So on a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you like or do not like this product? Do not like at all, like very much, and then the middle. So they rate it, and then you get a rating from 10 to 2. So you can see that predominantly, the refund program is very popular. And you can see that predominantly, the annual fee is highly unpopular. And of course, you can see the introductory APR is not popular either. So you have refund program has a positive impact, high APR has a negative effect, and then annual fee has a negative impact, you know. So, but then again, after doing this, you want to also look at the segment, which of the segment or which of the age cohorts is popular with a particular, you know, kind of attribute. So you can also measure that and look at, okay, so this is computing average ratings. Refund program, yes people is 6.75, no people is 4.25. Annual fee, those who said no, 7.5. Yes, 3.5. Introductory APR, 6.25. And no, well, and the 6% is 4.75. Estimated utilities by computing rating charges. So if you want to look at the utilities, you want to minus the lower we get, you know, from the higher, and then you get the values for the attributes. So each attribute, 2.5 for refund program, 4 for annual fee, and then 1.5 for introductory APR. Now, that is the segment you want to look at. Which segment is for what, you know, so that you will be able to properly target, you know, which of the attributes to which of the segment. So do you have to target, let's say, refund program to singles, or do you have to target annual fee to mature families? So you've got to understand so that you know which one will be favorable. So if you look at it, refund program is 2.5 for singles, you know, young families 3.2, and then mature families 1.0, which means this attribute is favored by this young family. And as we saw with over there in the other one, young families, because they have tight budget and things, will be highly, you know, kind of predisposed to refund programs, which is 3.2 of them. Annual fee, mature families think that they don't really care about paying one-off annual fee, you know, they would be able to do that. But you see, the singles, they don't want to pay annual fee, you know, it's not popular with them. And these people, just about 2.4 people. Introductory APR, all right, so introductory APR is 4%, 4% of these singles would want to go for, you know, introductory APR, and then, you know, 1.0 and then 0, which means that they probably could do the APR one so long as they can have, you know, refund program. So they are prepared to offset, you know, both ways. So cogent analysis, the pros and cons is that a small size sample size are typically sufficient. Again, lab setting helps contain competitive signal, and you'll be able to know, you know, which of the attribute is competitive. provides insight on variations to product attributes in addition to price, ability to analyze at individual consumer levels, so you're able to target properly. However, the current is that respondent fatigue, you know, because maximum 6 to 20 profiles approximately, you're giving them different profiles, and then they keep taking and taking, you know, there could be a fatigue in there. May not be externally valid, of course. So new product testing in financial services. So as we have actually developed the product, or you've actually come out with the new attributes and modified some of them, you need to test it to see whether it is still relevant, because you've used a set of groups, you know, to actually come out with the product. Now, you've got to then open up the sample a little bit higher so that you can test that whether it will work. So sample of new product in financial services, tuition fee protection, obviously 40-year home mortgages as a new product, terrorism event cancellation insurance, and then cancer life insurance in Japan. And like I said, we can also test, you know, the paragliding as a one-off insurance policy, and again, you know, to see whether people would actually take up. So if you want to test it, and usually we say that the life cycle for financial services, the incubation period is up to 2 years. That's when you are actually in a building the product, developing product concept. The introduction is up to 5 years. So once you have actually developed the concept that you've introduced it, the introduction stage lasts up to 5 years. That is for you to, you know, keep measuring and whether breaking even or, you know, doing tidbits here and there. So product launch and educating the consumer is part of the 5-year introduction. You know, example, identity theft insurance, telling people how it works, what's the benefits, you know, and what do they, you know, stand to gain, what do they have to do to have that, you know. And growth is up to 30 years. Every financial or most financial product or services, the growth rate is up to 30 years. That is when you achieve mass market, you know, kind of status. In example, cash cards, you know, they will be in the system for that 30 years. Maturity, that is when you are likely to experience the decline in the uptake of the product is mostly like decades, you know. That's when you realize that certain products are becoming obsolete. A typical example is check. You know, the check has been in existence for so long. It is now that we're experiencing what the downslide of it as a result of technology. You know, people transferring funds online every day and transferring funds via mobile money is making the check, you know, very unpopular. A lot of us even don't know how to write a check. As a result of that, I have been struggling to write a check for some time now. You know, every day I forget how to do it. You know, because it hasn't been a big part of us over the years. However, it's been in the system for some time now. I mean, decades, checks have been the use, and recently it's going there. So you can see the longevity of financial services. It takes quite a long time, decades, before you see the downslide of their use. All right, now when you're testing the marketing testing of financial services, a case for example is there's a case like FDM Bank, you know, has an option to test a product, and there's a lockdown, you know, for a mortgage lockdown, a property lockdown. So lockdown means that, you know, you take an option where when there's a slight, you know, kind of down trade of the mortgage cost, it doesn't affect, you know. So you take that option so that they lock down your interest, you know, so that it doesn't affect the property, you know, the value of the property. So when they develop that product, then they want to sort of test it in two markets to see, you know, which of them, you know, which of these two areas would love it. So 10,000 people were contacted, you know, in that locality, Cedar Rapids, by direct mail, you know, to offer them or to promote the FDM mortgage services, and 300 people applied for it. So 10,000 were contacted, 300 people applied. In the second, you know, locality, Period area, you have, you know, 9,000 people were contacted, only 540, you know, applied for the lockdown program. Now, to determine whether the lockdown has been effective or not, you've got to establish the effective rate. So we're saying that the effectiveness is, you know, whenever the effectiveness is greater than 2, it means it's been effective. So you calculate the first instance, The total number was 10,000. The people that responded is 300. So you get 0.03. And then you have here, the second case, the total number that were contacted is what? 9,000. The people that responded is 540. So you have 0.06. Now, like we're saying, if you calculate the two, it gives you what? 2.11. And then we're saying that effectiveness means anything that is greater than two. So in this case, it was effective. The test market proved effective. And as a result, they can actually, you know, perhaps continue with it. Now, the second scenario, it was a freedom banking, you know, service. So again, they contacted, you know, with particular offer. It says the regional provider of a retail banking service in mid-western United States has developed the concept for a no minimum balance check account program, branded as Freedom. So it's a zero check, zero account, what we call zero account, you know. So we call it Freedom account. And with the Freedom account, there are no minimum balance requirements in the check account in order to receive free check services. So they contacted people. Okay, so over a 6 month period, here are the statistics. 900 people who opened a standard check account, the average monthly balance was 3,215. The standard deviation in monthly balance was 550. Of the 700 people who opened a Freedom account, the average monthly balance was 3,150. The standard deviation in monthly balances was 470. Has the Freedom account caused a reduction in check deposits? So let's see. Again, when the effectiveness is greater than two, it means it has been effective. The test marketing has been effective, and we get what, 2.56. So again, it's been effective. So you can actually test, you know, the marketing using a larger sample after you've developed the product with a smaller sample, and then see the effectiveness of it. But of course, you've got to determine, you know, the determination of whether it's been effective or not depends on internal, you know, workings. I mean, what is the history of a take up of a particular service, and what is the percentage of increase given time, you know, and then given other circumstances. So you use that to determine what figure do you set or what benchmark do you set as effective. And as a result, when the test actually proves that it's greater than that benchmark, then of course it's been effective. So using test market data to predict profitability. Again, you want to predict your profitability before the product is actually wholly launched or when you've launched it. Again, for budgeting purposes and for forecasting purposes, you've got to actually do that. So do not launch and then launch. All right. So we have certain indicators to tell us whether we've got to go ahead with the launch or we've got to actually shelve it. So customers acquired nationally, 6,700. So do not launch. And then launch, 13,400. Profit per customer, 13,500 dinner launch, 10,500 launch. Total profit, again, incremental cost of advertising, 0.50 million. You see, so net profit is 90.4 million, 125.7 million launch. Now, certainly there will be limitation to this because sometimes you're actually doing it for other strategic reasons, other competition-wise, you know, because if you don't actually move in to protect, perhaps there's a future potential. There's a potential for this particular service. But in the present conditions, may not necessarily be lucrative. So the discussion is, do you just look at the quantitative measures or do you look at the qualitative aspect of it, the possibility of, you know, the next 2 years or the next year, you know, situation changing? You've got to take that decision. So if you have to rely on the quantitative figures, sometimes you may say do not launch before you realize your next competitor taking care of it. You know, I mean, gone are the days when we had a Millicom Ghana and what goes the space phone scenario. You know, I'm sure when mobile phones came in, we only knew them as bigger kind of things, like the YAM type of it. You know, we never thought that perhaps there could be smaller things. If, for example, Millicom Ghana had actually gone and say, would you like a phone that is too small like this? People said, no, it's likely I will lose it. All right. And therefore, they could actually fall on do not launch. But what did we see? It took off. Again, when it took off, and we had people using smaller phones like StarTAC, all right? If we had actually asked people, would you fancy a phone as big as your laptop? They would say, oh, no way, that's too big. Yet now we are looking at these Samsung tabs, big phones, and people actually holding it and using it, scribing it here and there. So sometimes we may not necessarily rely on the figures because it could deceive us. We have to look at the qualitative aspect. What is the lifestyle? How are people's lifestyle changing? What are people doing now these days? People are now using their phones as a communication tool, not only for talking, but as a comprehensive communication tool, sending emails, using it to plot their presentations and everything else. So bigger screens are becoming the fashion. Apple is now moving to bigger screens, you know, and other things, which means that you've got to look at the lifestyle of people before you make the decision to launch or not to launch. Otherwise, you actually have create a very fatal, you know, trouble. Facts about the product development process in financial services. New product concepts are often based on internal research rather than consumer feedback. You know, the cost of launching a new financial service is low compared to manufactured goods and is typically absorbed by existing infrastructure expenses. You know, test market can give away your strategy, of course, you know, to the competition, and larger institutions are more able to conduct formal consumer research. Market testing of financial product often becomes a full-blown product launch. So these days, because people are thinking that by the time you finish the test, somebody's launched it. So now people are actually launching in addition to test marketing. So as they launch, they ask you to send them feedbacks, and they ask you to. So they sort of encourage, you know, retaining product, you know, very, very well, because that's the only way they could actually see the limitations of the product and to perfect and match it. Because if they want to proceed with only testing, by the time they finish the test, somebody's launched it. So secondary sources of information, you know, use census data, industrial trends, of course, journals, you know, product magazines, you know, like Which and other things to kind of monitor. Advertising expositions or exposures, you know, billboards, TVs, and things will give you idea about new product. Sometimes complementary product will give you idea about new product, you know, what's happening, you know, like airlines, industries, and things, and how people are actually buying their ticket can give you an idea of what financial services you need to actually provide, you know, for people. Other secondary data. All right. Thank you so much for the session. I think we have seen how new products are introduced. It's easy in financial services, but it can be complicated, you know, at times. We understand what we have to do in order to identify, you know, attributes that will be acceptable or favorable to consumers and how they would want to pay for it. We have actually looked at conjoint analysis. We have looked at observational methods, open-ended questions. We've looked at focus groups and other things as methods of identifying or coming into terms with what, you know, factors do you have to introduce or modify to create a new product. Thanks very much, and time for questions, please.
Thank you very much, Doc. Yeah, it's a simple question. I just want to know the difference or the similarities between the test marketing of a good and the test marketing of a financial service.
But that's not a simple question. Goods and services testing, it's somehow, I mean, there's a difference, because when it comes to goods and services, you know, one is able to, as it were, even take it away, you know, to their own location and have a taste of it and retest it over a period of time before they bring it, all right? Which means that it affords you space and time, you know, that you can actually test it. Because you see, if I give you Apple, you have the convenience of taking it away and then going to test it and then recording your views and things like that. And then following day, maybe that day you were in bad mood, so you didn't taste it well. So you have the opportunity to actually test it the following day and then bring it. When it comes to services, as we know the characteristics of services, and as we always say, is consumption and production taking place at the same time. you know. So that affordance of space and time is not there. So that's one of the clear, you know. So you can't relieve it, you know, when it comes to services. It is here and now. And you may not have the opportunity to recall, you know, your facts, you know, and things like that. And you may not have the opportunity to brood over, you know. And taste is tangible when it comes to what you call goods and services. I mean, taste is tangible. You know, you can either feel it, hear it. The sensory is actually engaged. You know, the entire sensory is engaged. Now, when it comes to services, the only sensory, if I can call it that way, that is engaged is your brain. You know, if we can say that the brain is a sensory. I mean, it's a mental kind of picture, you know, that you can have and then perhaps do that. Now, there's no feel to it. You know, there's no taste to it, you know. So it makes it quite a difficult exercise when you ask consumers to test, you know, services. You know, they very much rely on their mental, you know, caution. They rely on mental abilities. And it makes it difficult for people to do as well. Some people shy away because of fear of looking stupid, you know, when it comes to financial services or when it comes to services in general. So people may shy away. So that's why when it comes to services, you want to make the testing thing so simple. And people may misunderstand it. Maybe you send them leaflets about this lockdown thing. What is lockdown? They may not really get it. And they don't want to respond back to you and ask you, can you explain to me lockdown? Because they may look stupid or they may seem stupid. So people shy away most of the time. You know, it's easy for them to shy away on financial services, you know, testing that product. I mean, it's easy to take a bottle of wine and say, it tastes nice. I mean, and then pass on your comments. But when it comes to financial services, it's difficult because of the characteristics of it. Yeah. All right. I hope it's helpful.
Okay, thank you very much, Doc. I would also like to know how you test products that take a long time to mature. For instance, maybe mortgages or pensions or term life insurance. How do you test it? Because it takes a long time for them to be able to give feedback about how they feel about their service.
Because of course, like you said, most of these products actually rely on what interest rate, which is much more a macro, you know, type of what you call indicators. So obviously, when it comes to financial services, and you want to test whether this particular product is going to afford customers the benefit that you're saying is going to afford, the power is not in your hands; it's in the atmosphere, you know. And as a result, it could take a lot of time. So usually, what companies do is that they introduce the product, but then in a very targeted, you know, consumer section. So it's more or less they have introduced it, you know. They don't do a big launch of it, but they introduce it within a particular locality or within a particular age cohort, you know, and then roll it out for them to use until such time that they think that the product, you know, has actually benefited. People have actually given feedbacks to say, oh, I really have benefited with this particular policy. I've benefited from this particular policy. Now, once that is gauged, then they look at the characteristics of the wider market and see whether it will be favorable. And then they push it out. So very much like it is introduced, you know, because like you said, the time and space is not there. You know, I mean, it takes a longer period for, you know, the product to mature. And as a result, they have to roll it out anyway, you know, because there's no way that you can actually anticipate, you know, the interest rate for next 2 years. You can't, you know. But there are things that are within your domain, within your constraint that you can actually, you know, test. And there are things that you can't. So perhaps you may want to introduce the product anyway, but then also introduce certain control measures. So maybe is it possible to put a small cash somewhere to offset certain costs that people that you haven't actually anticipated that will be the resultants of the product that you've introduced. Now, if you have promised people that we've predicted that interest rate is going to stay within 1.225 maybe in the next 10 years, and as a result introduce a new product there, and in the end it creeps to, let's say, 12, then people are going to say, but you said that it was going to. Now, obviously there are going to be legal challenges or they're going to be seeking of refunds. Do you have a pot of money to take care of that? So maybe you can set that one as a control measure, you know, to offset. But once it stays within, and then the prediction actually, you know, comes through, and then it grows and grows, then perhaps you want to launch it wider, you know, to the wider market, and as a result, you know, get it done to most people than not. So usually, yes, it is a difficult thing to do. So you might want to roll it out anyway with a particular small group with some control measures, and subsequently, by then you have learned it because there's a learning curve. So you might have learned quite a lot of things that you can use to modify the product that could be suitable for the general public. Thank you. All right, so thank you very much, you know, for today's session. I think it's been wonderful, and I hope you enjoyed it. I appreciate it. I enjoyed it as well, your questions. Thank you.